Helpline. I'm Ruchira, an expert here at Value Research, and I'm all set to answer your queries on investing and personal finance. Joining us is Ashutosh Gupta, who heads the mutual fund research team at Value Research. Welcome, Ashutosh.
Thank you, Ruchira.
Now, today's first question has been sent in by Vikram R, who is retired but still has a sizable equity portion in his portfolio. He has set up an SWP through it. Is it advisable to pause his SWPs from equity funds when there's a deep market correction to avoid selling a large number of units than usual?
Sure. Well, SIPs is a sound strategy to withdraw from equity when your goal is approaching. Because if you wait till the last time and if the equity markets correct sharply, then you can be stuck because of a deep value erosion in your accumulation. So it's always desirable to start withdrawing systematically from your equity investments at least a year or a year and a half before that to avoid any such situation. But having said that, formulating an SWP purely from an equity allocation for your regular income may not be a very dependable strategy, because as he rightly said, in times of deep market correction, he may end up depleting his accumulation too quickly, which is avoidable. So what he needs to do is set up an asset allocation with a combination of equity and debt, where equity could be say about 35-40% of his total accumulation. And once he does that, once he sets up this core portfolio, then he can keep transferring about the next 1 year's worth of income requirement in a liquid fund from where he can set up an SWP. Now, this equity debt asset allocation will work favorably for him during times of deep market correction where his concerns lie. That's because imagine a situation where a market is going through a deep correction right at the time when he's looking to transfer some of his accumulation into a liquid fund to set up an SWP. So at that point in time, the equity allocation from his portfolio, which would naturally fall below this 35-40% target allocation that he's looking to manage. And by virtue of that, he would naturally withdraw from his debt allocation to fund his liquid fund allocation. And by virtue of that, he would be avoiding selling at a time when equity markets are low. Likewise, the other way around, when the equity markets are running high, then you would naturally end up redeeming from equity because that allocation would be higher than the 35-40% target that he's keeping. And that's how he would end up not selling equity when the markets are low, but actually redeeming from them when the markets are running high. And because of that, it will work to his advantage through the ups and downs of the market. So that's the kind of portfolio that he can consider for his regular income.
Alright, now Eileen D'Souza has invested in liquid funds and she wants to know when will it be a good time for her to start STP in equity funds. She's been waiting for a while for market to come down before starting the STP.
Well, I'd suggest that she should go right ahead with her STP, because the STP itself is a hedge against the possibility of the market fall. That's because equity markets are fairly unpredictable, and if from here on the markets start falling after she starts her STP, then it will only work to her advantage because she would be accumulating units at lower levels. But on the flip side, if the markets keep going up and she continues to wait on the sidelines, then it will be a cause of great opportunity loss and it will bring its own stresses upon her. As I was saying, that markets are fairly unpredictable and these points of inflection come in the market when people least expect them and for the reasons which nobody could have anticipated. For instance, look back at the great market fall of 2008 or even the last year for that matter. Nobody saw them coming. Barely anybody could preempt them. And that's why it's futile to wait for those points of inflection, because you don't know when they could come. Markets can keep going up in a sustained way for a fairly long time, despite the overhang of concerns of valuations. So I'd say that having time at hand and investing systematically itself would ensure that she's able to make reasonable returns out of her equity mutual fund investments, irrespective of the level of the market where she starts investing from.
Now, Ramesh is investing in Mirae Asset Large Cap since the time it was in the multi-cap category. He has a few large caps already, so can he now switch from this fund to Mirae Asset Tax Saver for his retirement purpose?
Well, Mirae Asset Large Cap is one of the most promising actively managed large cap funds, and it has a kind of consistency in beating the index in recent years that few other large cap funds can match. And in fact, he's correct that this fund switched over from the multi-cap category to the large cap category sometime in the middle of 2019. But there has been style continuity through this transition. So even earlier when this fund was a multi-cap fund, it used to invest about 85 to 90% of its money in large cap stocks, and that has continued now. So by and large, there is style continuity. Now, he can consider shifting to the Mirai Asset Tax Saver Fund if he is looking to claim tax exemption under Section 80C. This fund happens to be again among the more promising ones in the ELSS category. But if the broad concern that he is trying to address is to reduce the amount of large cap exposure in his portfolio, because he mentioned that he already has exposure to some other large cap funds. So the concern, if he is trying to address, is that he is too heavily invested in large caps, then this switch may not help much, because even Mirai Asset Tax Saver invests heavily in large caps and consistently maintains a large cap exposure of about 70-75%. So to address this concern, I would suggest him to invest in one mid-cap and one small-cap fund. And to do that, he should avoid exiting from the Mirai Asset large-cap fund, but instead look to exit some other actively managed large-cap fund which he might have in his portfolio. Because as I said, that few other large-cap funds can match the consistency of this Mirai fund. So instead of this, he should look at exiting some other fund to then reinvest in a mid-cap and a small-cap fund.
Okay, so Ramesh, stick to Mirai Asset Large Cap for the time being. Now, Dilip Patil is a retiree and his PPF account will complete the extended period of 5 years this month. He needs to use this amount as supplementary income. So, should he extend it by another 5 years without contribution and withdraw the required amount once a year, or should he just close it and invest in debt funds?
No, I suggest he should continue with this PPF investment. In a PPF account, he is allowed to extend it by another 5 years, and he is also allowed to withdraw from this accumulation once a year. And more importantly, this investment is currently yielding 7.1% returns per annum, which is a pretty good return in the context of the way interest rates are in the economy right now. And the icing on the cake is all these returns are completely tax-free, because the earnings from PPF are tax-free. So essentially what he gets is a safe investment, which also offers a reasonable amount of liquidity. On top of it, it is offering handsome returns and returns that are tax-free. So what more would a fixed income investor need or hope for in the current context from his fixed income investments? So I would suggest he should forget about any debt funds for the moment and continue with his PPF investment and keep drawing from it annually. So that's what I'd advise him for this particular investment. But more broadly, I'd say that even in case of a retiree, some allocation to equity is necessary, because sooner or later you start losing out to inflation. And I hope he's factored that in with some of his other investments in his overall portfolio.
Okay, the next question has been sent in by Akshay Thakur. He has been using FDs to hold his emergency funds. He's evaluating the options of investing in liquid funds, but in the current scenario with low interest rates, their yield is below inflation rates. So, is there any option to earn at least inflation-adjusted returns without putting his capital at risk?
So, one is that one should always prioritize safety, liquidity and low volatility over returns as far as the allocation for emergency needs is concerned. So, broadly, I'd say that a bank account with a sweep-in facility, their surpluses beyond a certain threshold get automatically invested in an FD, is also a viable option, because there is no compromise on liquidity and withdrawals from such an account are pretty seamless. But he should remember that in case of an FD, if you withdraw prematurely and break it, then there is a penalty that you have to incur, and the returns even from an FD fall. The other thing is, if you continue to hold on to your emergency corpus and keep it invested for more than 3 years, which I hope is the case, and I hope he doesn't land in an emergency situation, then in that case, FDs tend to be less tax efficient in comparison to debt mutual funds, and therefore that investment in a debt mutual fund in that case turns out to contribute meaningfully to the returns, more so in case of someone in a higher tax bracket. Now, having said that, talking about liquid funds, well, yes, their returns have been fairly low in the recent times. Forget about inflation, they've barely been able to match up to the returns of a savings bank account, and that's because interest rates have been fairly low, more so at the shorter end of the maturity. But from here on, hopefully the returns from liquid funds should improve. And that's because since January, the yields on the bonds have been on the rise. Now, what happens with liquid funds is, because they invest in bonds which are maturing in less than 91 days, so their portfolio comes up for redeployment pretty quickly. There is a pretty high churn in the portfolio because, as I said, the fund does not hold bonds of a maturity of more than 3 months in the first place. Now, what is happening is, as progressively their portfolios are coming up for redeployment, that reinvestment is happening at relatively higher yields, and that should contribute to higher returns from these funds from here on. In fact, we can already see a slight uptick in the yields to maturity of several liquid funds as per their last disclosed portfolios. And from here on, since the general expectation is that there would be an upward bias on the yields of bonds, so that should contribute towards improving the returns of liquid funds. But having said that, it's still a far cry from the 6% or higher returns that liquid funds used to generate till some time back. So from that perspective, one needs to keep his or her expectations a little moderate, and that's the kind of returns one has to live with. At best, he can consider adding assigning some of this money to an ultra short duration fund, which will be slightly more volatile but can generate slightly higher returns. But I'll reiterate that he should not focus too much on returns for his emergency needs and rather focus on safety and liquidity.
Alright, now Dr. Rajesh Megara wants to know, are medium and long duration debt funds and gilt funds suitable for a time horizon of 7 to 8 years?
No, I would advise against it. At a time when bond yields are rising, these are the funds which tend to suffer the most because of the rise in interest rates and yields, and therefore they are avoidable at this stage. But I'd suggest him that if he can stretch his investment horizon a little bit to just under 9 years, then the Bharat Bond ETF, the 2030 variant, offers a compelling investment option, because that fund is currently yielding a shade over 7.1%, which is a pretty attractive rate of return in the current context. So what he gets from this investment is a fairly negligible credit risk, a decent enough return, and a predictable return. And all of those make it a pretty compelling option in the current scenario. So that's the one that I'll recommend to him, provided he can stretch his investment horizon a little bit. But more broadly, I'd also suggest him, for his investment horizon, he can also consider having a measured exposure to equities.
Now, Shivanand Yatsangi asks, is the indexation benefit while calculating long-term capital gains available only to debt mutual funds and not equity?
Yes, understanding is correct. The indexation benefit is currently available only for while calculating the long-term capital gains taxes on debt funds and not the equity ones. So the way it works is that if you hold on to your equity investment for more than 1 year, then the gains are taxed at a flat rate of 10%. While in case of debt, you have to hold them for at least 3 years, beyond which the capital gains are taxed at the rate of 20% after providing the indexation benefit. Now, this indexation is a very useful and a very logical concept. It adjusts your cost of acquisition for any security to inflation. So, taking an example, for instance, you buy a security at a cost of rupees 100 and you hold on to it for several years. Now, over this time period, because of the general price rise in the economy, if you are to sell this investment today, then adjusting for all the inflation of all these years, let's say your cost of acquisition will increase to rupees 125. So this is the price which will be assumed to be your cost of acquisition for calculating your capital gains tax liability, instead of the original rupees 100 which you actually paid for that security. So in effect, the indexation benefit has the effect of lowering your capital gains for the purpose of calculating the tax liability, and therefore it lowers your overall tax liability. Now, you know, whether he should remember that in case of equity, while the indexation benefit is not available, but the tax rate itself is lower. Now, whether that works out in his favor or not will depend upon the accumulated level of capital gains tax and what was the prevailing inflation during the time of his holding period. So those are the kind of factors that will govern whether having indexation benefit or not works to his advantage or not. But anyways, these are the variables which are beyond his control. Tax laws are such, and we have to simply play by them.
Now, C.S. Ram has sent in the next query, and he wants to know if there is an upper limit to the amount that can be invested in a mutual fund in the name of a minor per year.
No, there is no upper limit, and he can invest as much as he wants. But there are some considerations that he needs to keep in mind while investing in the name of a minor. One is that one cannot invest in a joint name. So one cannot have a joint holding when one is investing in the name of the minor. But there is a need of a guardian who effectively runs this account till the time the child becomes a major. And once the child attains the age of majority, then transactions in this account will be temporarily suspended till the time he completes some documentation to convert that account into that of a major. And after that, the child becomes the sole owner, pretty much like any other regular investment, and gets the rights to make any transactions in that account.
Purvish Patel asks, is a quality stock portfolio or a quality biased mutual fund a sure shot way of wealth creation, irrespective of valuation considerations?
Well, that's a fairly interesting question and a pretty debatable one. But let me provide my perspective, which is based upon several interactions with several fund managers who often face this price versus quality conundrum. So one is that nothing is good at any price, because even for the best of the companies, you would want to attach some value beyond which you feel that it is the price is not worth it. But having said that, most fund managers would contend that they would rather prefer a solid business, buying a solid business at a relatively expensive valuation than a questionable business at a very attractive price, because it's a quality where one can exercise a greater control than price. And fund managers would contend that over a period of time, if you have quality businesses, even if you overpay for them a little bit, then over a period of time, you can still hopefully make good returns. Because if you look at the track record in the Indian markets, a lot of quality businesses would almost always look expensive and yet turn out to be wealth compounders because of the inherent growth. But on the contrary, questionable businesses may not survive the test of the time and turn out to be wealth destroyers even from a cheap valuation. So I'd broadly say that quality, provided there is a growth characteristic inherent in the business along with time at hand, can compensate for some error of judgment on price, provided it is not completely out of whack.
Alright, now Akash Kumar is facing an issue updating his SIP investments in the My Investments tool on Value Research Online ever since SEBI changed the rule on the date of allotting units with respect to realization of funds. So he asks, suppose his SIP date is 1st of February and the AMC realizes the money on the 5th. It will assign the NAV units of 5th February only. So how will it get updated in VR portfolio, he wants to know.
Well, yes, there has been an operational hassle which has resulted from this recent change in the regulation. So what has happened is that earlier, for investments up to rupees 2 lakhs, you could get the NAV of the same date as the date of your SIP. But now what SEBI has said is that you would get the units allotted and you would get the NAV only of the date on which the money actually hits the bank account of the mutual fund scheme. So what happens is that from your SIP date, there might be a delay of a 1 or a 2 or a 3 day depending upon the efficiency of the payment process which is being used in your case. So there could be a slight delay from the actual date of SIP which you have recorded or which you mandated by filling up the form and when the money actually hits the bank account of the scheme. And depending upon when it hits the bank account, you would be allotted the NAV of that day. So what has happened is that for portfolio tracking systems like the one on Value Research Online, if somebody comes and sets up an SIP for a set date, but actually the money gets credited 2 or 3 days later, so the actual transaction will happen on that date and not on the date of the SIP. And this date can vary, so there is no way to preempt when the money would get credited and what date would I get the NAV of. So that has created this bit of a hassle. So for now, the only solution that I'd suggest and which would work pretty well is to use the auto-import functionality of the My Investments tool at Value Research, where one can simply every month use that auto-import functionality, which is pretty quick and simple and efficient to use, and trigger an auto-import and that would capture all the transactions accurately and on the date when they actually get affected. So one would not need to do any manual entries and yet be able to capture all the transactions efficiently and accurately.
Okay, now today's last question has been sent in by Ramesh, and he wants to know if it's the right time to invest in lump sum and balanced advantage funds when their equity allocation is running low.
Well, no. Balanced advantage funds have a sizable equity allocation which subjects them to the ups and downs of the equity markets. So their NAVs can be subjected to deep corrections when the equity markets fall sharply. And that's why one should avoid investing in them in lump sum and continue to invest through the SIP. Also, if one thinks intuitively, the equity allocation of balanced advantage funds would be low when the fund manager is of the view that the equity markets are running high and may be ripe for correction. And that's all the more reason to avoid investing in lump sum in these funds. But in any case, this is just a matter of nuance. But I'd suggest that more broadly, one should not overcomplicate things and avoid basing one's investment strategy on the level of equity in a fund's portfolio. So one should avoid all that complexity, keep it simple, and stick to the good old SIP.
Well, with that, it's a wrap on this episode of Healthline. Thank you, Ashutosh.
Thank you.